Hello, I'm Donna.
I'm Sarah.
I'm Justyna.
Today on Less Code, More Power, something that's never happened before has happened. Sarah and I are speechless.
It's true.
You are also going to be speechless when you learn how data saves lives. Stay tuned. Hello, welcome to Less Code, More Power. Today's episode is unlike any of the other ones you've seen before. I'm Donna.
I'm Sarah.
And I'm Justyna.
Today we've got an extraordinary guest, the guru of Power BI.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right, that's her. So I saw her present at Ignite last November, and I was so blown away at how interesting her presentation was and how fascinating she made Power BI, a thing that I'm honestly kind of scared of, that we knew that we absolutely had to have her on the show.
You're too kind.
Oh, no, not at all. Yeah. To come share all of this magic of Power BI and to showcase how people, ordinary people like me, who know really nothing about dashboards and visualizations can do it too. So tell us about you. Yeah. Why Power BI? How did you get into it? How did it find you? How did you find it?
Yeah, it was a pretty unique journey. Yeah. I was actually studying politics, and wow. I was planning on being a diplomat, and and then I realized that that wasn't going to happen. I somehow ended up in Microsoft, but I was always really, really into all the quantitative research and doing all the stats, even when we do our projects, I'd always be gravitating towards, okay, I want to do the number crunching. And so when I joined Microsoft, Power BI was actually still an Excel plugin.
Wow. No way.
Remember that?
Yeah, I joined the product group, I think about 2 months before we went GA with the Power BI desktop product.
Amazing.
And so, yeah, I kind of knew that I wanted to get into data. I wanted to do something with business intelligence. So I ended up on the Power BI product group. And
I love that. You've literally been from day one.
Yeah.
Literally. And also, I guess the thing that I found fascinating about this is the politics piece, because I guess from that side of things, you actually understand how truly, like, kind of data can matter and influence. Like, as in, like, kind of, especially because that's so ingrained in politics.
Oh, yeah.
So, like, I love that you're kind of still doing stuff that you kind of were, like, originated in almost.
Yeah, totally. And Power BI is actually all about, you know, improving data literacy. That's kind of our mission statement, you know?
I love that, improving data literacy.
Yeah, so it's all about like replacing opinions with facts, being data driven.
Wow. Yes.
So yeah, it's really, really aligned with.
That's cool.
That is fantastic. That is so cool. So you've brought a very, very cool demo. Do you want to talk to us about it?
Yes. So this is actually a demo that originated from a Gartner BI bake-off.
BI bake-off. Just everyone understand what we just said right there.
We did say bake-off.
Gartner BI bake-off.
Yes.
All right, please explain what that is, because that is some news.
Yeah.
So every year, Gartner invites the top BI vendors for their conference.
Yes.
A month before the conference, they send all the BI vendors a data set.
Yes.
And a couple of questions and tasks.
Yes.
And we have a month to prepare the best possible demo we can with this data set. And then we all go into a bake-off.
You know, you're really inspiring me here. We should do like an app off or an app bake-off or something. Like, we'll park
Give them
this.
A topic, everyone make apps and go present it.
Yeah. We're going to park that. You'll see that on another show.
Yeah, that's going to be funny. All right, and then what happens? So you prepare a demo.
You prepare a demo. You show up at a conference. Yes. All the other vendors are there on stage with you. You have a live audience. And then it's like the data prep round. Or the dashboarding round.
Data prep round. So there's actually, like, you have to show them how you've done it.
Yes.
Yes.
So some of it is demoing what you've already built, and some of it is go build it from scratch right now in front of everyone.
Wow.
Oh.
So no smoke and mirrors here.
No, you literally have to build, like, in front of thousands of people. Wow.
And if you go over time, there's a buzzer, they buzz you off, and then everyone has to vote for who they like the most.
Wow, that is an intense amount of pressure.
X factor.
Yeah, X factor for dashboards. For dashboards.
And visualizations. I did not know about this until right now. I am so amazed at this. Yeah. So you're competing in this thing.
Yeah. So we've got us, we've got Tableau, we've got Click, we've got SAP.
Wow.
So you've got some real challenges there.
Absolutely.
These are some hard hitters. So tell us what's the word. We're getting a sneak peek at what they're just showing, by the way. This is this conference was months ago, so
Yes.
No spoilers.
No spoilers.
Yes.
So every year it's about data for good.
Yes.
This year it was all about health and life expectancy and what governments and the private sector can do to improve the population's life expectancy.
Amazing.
So we got some World Health Organization and World Bank data. Mm-hmm. Wow. And then we had a month to prepare whatever we could.
Amazing.
Wow. Yes, so it's actually helping people at the same time. Yeah. Like it has that kind of angle too.
I like that the whole conference is focused on that, data for good. That's really interesting. I like how none of us knew about this until right now. Yes. Now we know. Mm-hmm. Okay, so tell us.
Yeah, so okay, let's dive into the demo. Yeah. And so what you're seeing on the screen over here is the world life expectancy in the year 1800.
Okay.
Wow.
And things weren't looking too good in 1800.
Yeah, not too great.
Really bad. Under 30?
Yes. I would probably be in the middle of my retirement at the moment.
Wow.
and you know what? If we go and look at it, let's say 100 years into the future, so 1900, not much changes.
No.
World life expectancy is still pretty bad.
Pretty dire.
We increase it to 34. The map is still all red
and
orange.
The oldest people are 60, not even.
No, 45 to 59 is the best case scenario.
Wow.
Best case scenario.
59. So you don't even hit retirement.
No.
Really, kind of.
No. I think retirement might have been a little bit
like retirement is like
retirement
retired.
For the modern world.
That's so bad. Okay, wow, all right.
But take a look what happens. So let's fast forward to 1918 over here. And life expectancy drops to 23.
No way.
What?
Yeah. So initially I thought this was like a data quality issue.
Yes.
And I started researching into it and no, this is real.
This is real.
This is real.
Did you find the cause? Like, what actually happened?
I did. It was the Spanish flu.
Spanish flu.
The Spanish
flu
hits the world. It infects 27% of the world's population.
27%?
And it had that impact on the life expectancy.
Yes. It wiped out 50 to 100 million people.
My gosh.
Okay. So
did not know that.
Yeah. Bigger impact than, you know, over here you can see World War II.
Yes.
Bigger impact than World War II.
That's insane.
That's kind of, that's amazingly interesting because I guess you would never have really found that out if you hadn't done this.
That's right.
Like you hadn't had this like visualization, you hadn't had this task.
Yeah, so it was actually a really fascinating task of actually just exploring all this data because I learned a lot.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So then we kind of went forward into like the 50s, the 60s, and you know, things actually started to improve. We discovered penicillin, got antibiotics going. But this number is also pretty deceiving because things improved a lot in, you know, countries like, let's say, Norway, who jumped to like 70 years of life expectancy. But in the developing world, a lot of countries are still actually living just into the 30s.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
But if we actually fast forward to today, you know, let's just take a moment to celebrate this amazing progress that has happened. Because
and that's in a short space of time there, right?
Yeah, super
that's
short
not
space
even
and
that
time.
Long.
Yeah. We know life expectancy jumped to 73. The biggest improvements actually came from developing countries. We've really closed this gap of health inequality.
From 30 to like to almost 70.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's amazing.
So yeah, really, really cool progress.
I'm in love with this dashboard, though. Like, just, like
Sarah's
just
like, I want this dashboard.
I am seriously in love with this.
I want
Can
it on my wall.
Can you do that thing again?
Like, can you do the thing with the slider moving?
Yeah, because I just love this. Because like the thing is, like it really makes probably what looked like quite boring data that you originally received. And it really brings it to life. It's like a real kind of tool for storytelling.
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Exactly.
So it's all about, you know, a lot of people just think, okay, I'm just going to throw a couple of, you know, visuals onto
charts and graphs on this and call it.
But there's such an art to actually taking this all together. You should have seen, by the way, I work with a very, very talented report designer. When I threw this report to him, it was literally like, okay, here's a bunch of pages with charts. Can you just
make
bring
it
this
good?
Together?
Can you make it good?
So shout out to Miguel. Thank you so much.
Yay, thank you, Miguel.
Yeah, this is amazing.
You know, for this sort of data storytelling, it's so important to have something that has been thought out in terms of how everything integrates together. Mm-hmm. So yeah, it was, I was so excited when I saw this for the
this
first time.
This is beautiful. I love just, you can explain this to anyone so easily.
Mm-hmm.
Right, without them being at all confused about like, wait, what about that row or, you know, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, you know, so then the next question was, okay, well, what actually happened in that last decade that improved life expectancy so much, right? So one of the things that happened is less children are dying at a young age.
Oh, okay.
That's good.
Yes.
That's good.
So if we actually go back and look at what the world looked like just 30 years ago, I'm not going back 200 years, 30 years ago. What you're seeing over here is life expectancy by child mortality. And you can immediately see that in the areas where we have high life expectancy, child mortality is very, very low.
Yes.
But then there are also countries here on the right-hand side where 1 in 3 children are dying before the age of 5.
What? One
just
in three?
Just 30 years ago.
Before the age of 5?
Mm-hmm.
That's very young.
Wow, that's kind of, that's scary. That's
it is. When I actually saw this data, it took me kind of a moment and I had to reflect on it because it was you know, pretty crazy. But then take a look at what happens, you know, in the past 30 years. And there are a couple of exceptions where things kind of go a bit weird. So actually observe at the beginning, this dot over here, which is Rwanda. And you can see as we move forward, Rwanda actually goes all the way to the right first.
Oh, wow, yes. It did. It kind of made like this kind of like weird shape, right?
Yeah. And that was the genocide that happened,
that's right?
Yes,
right. That's right.
So you can see how these factors can just have these huge impacts. But generally, everything's moving to the left. Everything is moving up.
Yes.
That dot over there that kind of flashed before us, that was the Haiti earthquake.
Oh. Wow. Exactly. So you can actually pinpoint this stuff.
Events in history.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It really kind of brings history to life.
Yes.
And then you look at reasons and with that data, like, I love this stuff. This is amazing.
This is very cool.
And, you know, the great news is that in the countries that saw this, you know, very high child mortality, things actually got reduced to cases of 1 in 10. So huge progress that happened in just a very, very short space of time. And if we actually want to dig into one of these countries and see what's been going on, you know, we can just click on the dot, we can see the journey it went on, and we can see how all of these top indicators have been changing. So in a country, in this case, this is Sierra Leone that we're looking at, you can see how much immunizations have actually increased.
Wow.
They're still below the global average, but they've gone into this amazing journey in the past 30 years.
Turns out science works. Who knew?
Wow. Yeah. Me and Donna are just like,
We're amazed at this.
Honestly, I think we've said wow and amazing.
Like, we are not speechless that much right now. We're like, wow, look, science works. And the data actually shows it.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Yes. This is cool.
Yeah, it really brings it to life. I cannot say that in like kind of, and you're right, you know, I really can't, I can't stop thinking about when you said, people just throw some charts on, like in Power BI, and I'm guilty of this. I just throw some stuff on a like dashboard, and I'm like, that's a Power BI chart,
yes,
woohoo.
Absolutely.
Whereas I think this demo really shows the capability of
the power of storytelling.
Yeah, it's like storytelling, it's visualization, and really to gather true insights from that data.
Yeah.
Yeah, all these insights I'm telling you about, I just discovered by playing around with the data myself, and you know, it was just a kind of fascinating journey to go on.
I love that.
Yeah.
That is fascinating.
So one other thing I wanted to show you was we also have some built-in AI visualizations into Power BI.
Okay.
Can that actually help you do a lot of this just analysis automatically for you?
Make you look good to your boss without you doing the work.
So over here, I've dropped in what we call the key drivers or key influencers visualization. Mm-hmm. And what I've done is I was given like literally hundreds of indicators.
Yeah.
So I was like, okay, which ones actually matter?
Yes.
So I split them out into these different categories like you see over here, like health expenditure, socioeconomic, lifestyle.
Yeah.
And then I just threw all of them into the visual. And I said, tell me what's important. And so what this visual does is it runs a machine learning model, stack ranks all of these different factors, and just automatically tells me what matters. And so the top factor that's associated with increasing life expectancy that you can see over here is actually access to safe drinking water.
Oh, fascinating.
Populations which have higher access to safe drinking water, in this case 85% of the population or more, on average live 13 years longer.
Wow.
And you can
see safe drinking water.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then you can see your data actually on the right-hand side. Mm-hmm. That's representing this particular insight.
You actually get to see why it's that high, like as in
that's
why
right.
the dashboard or why, you know, not that there's a person in the dashboard or anything, but in terms of why it's at the top compared to the others.
Exactly, and that was actually the reason why we built it this way. It was so that we don't just give you a black box model. You can click on that factor
and
actually see the underlying data that's explaining that insight.
And what I love even more about this, I am blown away. Like, I am just like, when
very amazed at what we're seeing.
When we've been going to the demo, Donna and I are just like at the screen, like with our mouths open, like,
this
oh
is
my
very
God.
Interesting.
Like, so good.
I think this is a sign that you and I need to do better at Power BI.
We probably should, to be fair. Like,
but we have the guru.
Yeah. You can teach us.
Yeah.
The thing that I really love about this is that you didn't have to make any decisions about what data you chose. Because the thing is, a lot of the time people, you know, you're not an expert in the data. You get the data to present it visually, to put it into the tool. And, you know, to make those decisions is quite hard because, like you said, you have no idea which one's relevant. What should I put in there? Whereas this capability is enabled you to put everything in there and let the tool do it for you.
I mean, literally, if we are into this field well pane, you can see I've just put in, I want to analyze life expectancy. Yes. It was this easy to build. I just dragged and dropped these fields. And I said, just analyze all of these different fields. I'm just going to drop everything that's to do kind of socioeconomic related. And then just stack rank them for me, right? So it's that easy. But this visual is also fully interactive. So if I only want to look at indicators that impact females, for example, I can click on females over here, and the regression model reruns.
Wow.
Okay.
And now we're seeing the top factor that comes up is education. Education is super important. You know, when we have higher levels of education where females are able to go to school, then again, that impacts life expectancy as well.
Wow.
We're I would never assume they're related. No. I know they're both important. Yeah. I didn't know they're related.
And we're
a
big fan of education, right?
That's
We've had a number of guests talking about like why education is so
why
important.
Education is important.
Yeah, the fact that it's now linked to life expectancy or that we've learned that it's linked
literally
to life expectancy.
Literally saves lives.
Yeah.
Wow. Did not know.
And we can also just do a quick search. So I think you're from the UK.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
So this is a British accent.
Let's
start. Life expectancy UK. Let's see it, Sarah. This is your fault.
I'm a little bit worried.
So if we typed in Great Britain over here, you can see, again, the visual just updated. And here it's actually to do with how much income is shared by the lowest 20% of the population. So the poorest 20% of the top population.
Wow.
When they have more income coming to them, that again impacts life expectancy.
Wow.
Because in the UK, probably safe drinking water has been something that's been probably taken for granted for a long time.
Yeah,
there hasn't been much
time.
Variation in that. Mm-hmm. So that income is up as an influencer. But you know, how much of the income is shared by the poorest 20%?
I love how it changes based on the location as well, because it doesn't just kind of, again, it's very dynamic.
Yes.
So you can easily pinpoint what is affecting the world in the most way?
Yeah.
Is it
in
drinking
the most
water?
Micro
is it
way.
Yeah.
Right? Per region, per country.
Yeah. Yeah. And the the machine learning model actually just reruns on the fly. So it throws away the old one, builds you a new one, literally on the spot.
You could just set up a booth at the UN.
Yeah.
And they'd come by and say, okay, how do we get our life expectancy up to here?
Well,
you're like, let me run this for you.
Yeah.
Water.
Yeah.
Educate your women.
Yes.
You know, et
cetera. Wow.
Yeah. Wouldn't that be really fascinating?
Yeah. You know, maybe not a booth at the end, but I really want to think about what more can we do with this data, because now that it's built, I just feel like I want to get into hands of other people
People who can actually go make environmental changes happen in their countries.
Yeah.
It's so fascinating for just like the Minister of Health and Education and stuff to know about.
To actually kind of, because we're all about identifying problems and creating apps to solve them, right?
That's right.
But it's about, this is like, helps you identify those problems.
Yes.
This kind of stuff, because it's kind of a full circle. You identify the problems, you build apps, you get the data,
you
identify the problems, you build apps, you get the data.
Get the data, yeah.
Yeah, it's like this, I'm blown away. Like I am I am pretty much speechless. Well, nothing can really make me speechless, but.
Close.
Yeah.
Yeah, that is awesome. Thank you so much for sharing that.
Mm-hmm.
So we never let our guests leave without assigning homework to all of you.
Mm-hmm.
So Justyna, we're sure you've got a homework assignment for our audience.
Yes, and hopefully this should be an easy one.
Mm-hmm.
Please go ahead and download the Power BI desktop. You can download it for free. It stays for free forever. You can just use it, play around with it, get some data into it, build out some reports, try out some of these AI visuals. Mm-hmm. They're just built into the product. And you can get started with Power BI super, super quickly this way.
Look That's amazing. I just want to make this even easier. So would you recommend any free data sites? I know that some governments and some countries do that. Would you recommend any good ones? Because then we're not gonna let you have the excuse of I've not got the
data. I have not no data. My data's boring.
So a really good one that I use very often myself is called Kaggle.com.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually a site for data scientists and data science competitions, but they provide a ton of free data sets. You can just search for any topic you're interested in, download a CSV, load it into Power BI, and you're off building your first dashboard.
You're off in business.
Mm-hmm.
I think even we can figure this out today.
Yeah.
I'm very much an app person or a virtual agent person, and I've avoided dashboards because they're hard.
I'm
but
trying
this
to change your mind.
It's actually working. It's working. This is interesting. It'll be so cool to see social media trends, which of our shows are doing well, et cetera, et cetera. That would be fascinating.
Yeah, and you can even do it for your retail business, right?
I could even do it for my retail business. There's so many use cases I can think of. All right, we are of course out of time because we don't know how to shut up.
Nope.
Thank you so much for tuning in. Till next week, I'm Donna.
I'm Sarah.
I'm Justyna.
We are Less Code, More Power. Thank you.